This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I can have what it says I can have. Today, I'm ready to receive the incorruptible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. Come, Holy Spirit, have your way in this place. Come, Holy Spirit, have your way in my life. I'll never be the same again. Never, never, never. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Now, I like to preach to people that are well. If you're hurting this morning, God wants to touch you. He doesn't want me to preach to sick people. He wants me to preach to well people that are excited about what God's going to do. Well, if God healed you right now, wouldn't you be excited?
Yes.
All right, lay hands on your body and let's believe God. Father, we rebuke sickness. We rebuke disease. We rebuke pain. Every person in this building right now, be healed and receive what God has for you. In Jesus' name, amen. God's healing somebody that had a real stomach problem. God's already healed you. Check around and see. It's gone. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Somebody was having trouble with your chest, congestion in your chest. It's healed. Praise God. Healed. Aren't you glad God's a healer? Well, if you got your Bibles, we're going to read in Romans chapter 10, beginning with verse 6. Romans 10, verse 6. But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. Say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring up Christ again from the dead. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart, that is the word of faith which we preach, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Thank you, Lord, for the reading of your word. Now, I'm going to share from that scripture, but I wanted to kind of set the stage of what I believe God laid in my heart. Last week, if you remember, you were here, Pastor Mark, who, by the way, is at Passion Church this morning with some of our children workers to see how they do their children's program. So that's why I'm preaching today. Mark's not here. But he preached on David killing Goliath. How many were here last Sunday? You heard that message about David killing Goliath. Well, here was a little ruddy teenager that his daddy sent him over to see his brothers. Three of them were in the army. And they're faced off with the Philistines. The Philistines on this mountain over here and the children of Israel on this mountain over here. And then the Philistines send out a champion, Goliath, who they say was over 9 feet tall. How many believe that's pretty tall? 9 feet tall. That's, your head would be hitting the ceiling. That's how tall it is. So here he is coming out, and he said, look, if I'm making a challenge to you. If you come and you kill me, then we'll be your servants. But if I kill you, then you're going to have to be my servant. Now he's talking to people. The children of Israel, these are not a bunch of cowards. These are mighty warriors in the army. But what they're looking at is naturally impossible. A giant, 9 feet tall, with a sword bigger than you. I mean, this is impossible. So nobody wants to take the challenge. But here comes David. He comes in. And he's the one that decides, I can do something about this, because there was something that he knew that probably some of the others did not know. And what God spoke to me, as Mark was preaching last week, the Lord put in my heart, is there not a God in Israel? Is there not a God in Israel? And so after Mark was through and I looked it up and found it in the Bible, and it was where a king was sick, and he said, I want you to go talk to Beelzebub and find out if I'm going to get well. And so they come across the prophet, and the prophet said, why are you looking for an unbeliever, heathen, false god to get your healing? Is there not a God in Israel? And so I looked and then I went back over the scripture that Mark was reading in 2 Samuel chapter 17. What David said was, there is a God in Israel. There is a God in Israel. In other words, if I look at this situation in the natural, I don't want to go down there. There's a giant down there in the valley waiting on somebody to come down there. I don't want to go down there in the natural and face a giant. But I know something. There is a God in Israel. And this is what caused him then to go to Saul and let him know that he wanted to fight this giant. Now, all of us here this morning are facing giants. And your giants are huge. You may have a giant of financial problem. You may have a giant of sickness, cancer, some other dreaded disease in your body. There may be a giant of rebellious children. There may be a giant of addiction. It is impossible. You've tried to defeat it. You don't know what to do. You've tried everything. And you've come to the place where you've learned to live with it. No, is there not a God in Douglasville this morning? Is there not a God that's bigger than your giant that you're facing? So this is what I want you to know. There is a God here this morning. He showed up in church this morning. In fact, I brought him. I decided if I was going to go, God might as well go. Because he lives in me. He lives in you if you're a child of God. So it's a sad commentary that this morning when we are facing giants, that we want somebody else to fight for us. We want somebody else to take up a shield and go face this giant. But I'm here to tell you, you do not need anybody else if you've got God. God and you are more than enough for any giant that needs to be slain this morning. And we're going to slay some giants this morning. Some that are nipping at your heels and causing you to have fear and problems. God wants you to know you don't have to leave the way you came. Hallelujah. God wants to do something about it. Now, the only weapon that David had as he ran down the hill to face the giant was a sling. And the Lord, I believe, revealed to me the sling that we New Testament Christians have is the Word of God in our spirit and on our lips. The Word of God in our spirit and on our lips. We can defeat any giant with that little sling. We don't have to have anything else. We don't have to have a massive army to walk down into the valley with us. We've got the weapon that God wants us to have to kill that giant that's bothering us. Now, a little old sling, if you look at it, is not very effective. If all you were looking at is the sling, you'd get discouraged. Because what is the sling compared to a giant 9 feet tall with a shield and a sword and ready to cut your head off? It's not very much. It's not a very big weapon. Well, when I stand up and tell you that your giant, no matter what it is, no matter how big it is, no matter how long you've tolerated it, you have something that's bigger than that giant. And you, if you know how to use it, can take that little sling and you can kill that giant. That ought to be good news to somebody because some of you have tolerated it too long. It's time that you stood up and found out, what do I need to do? So let me ask the question, what did David have that made that little sling such an effective weapon? I believe David was a young man of faith. Well, how can you say that? I can say it because the Bible says that David was a man after God's own heart. And the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So we know then that David was a man of faith. David had faith. And David, since he was a man of faith and lived under the Old Testament, we have to know then that he knew some things about the power of words, because he knew the world was created by the Word of God. God said, "Let there be light." And in the creation in Genesis chapter 6, everything that was created by the Word of God. That means, folks, if you don't know it, everything you see, everything that is visible and tangible in this earth was created by words. He also had to know, if he read the Old Testament, and he wrote a lot of the Psalms, and one of the Psalms says, "By the word of the Lord were the heavens created." God's word created the heaven. Now we in the New Testament can go further, because Jesus said in Matthew, he said, "You're going to give an account for every idle word that you speak. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned." This means, now this is Christianity 101, but if you don't pass Christianity 101, you're not going to graduate. You'll keep your giants the rest of your life. This is simple. By your words, you're justified. By your words, you're condemned. That means God's on your side. God's rooting for you. God has made a way for you to be perfect, entire, wanting nothing. God's made a way for you to be well. God's made a way for you to pay your bills. God has made a way. Where there seemeth to be no way, God made a way. And the devil knows that his job is to steal, to kill, and to destroy. He does not want you healthy. He does not want you to pay your bills. He does not want your children saved. He does not want anything good for you. You stand in the middle. Which way will you go? You decide. God does not decide how well you live. You decide how well you live. You have the key that unlocks the door and slays the giants. And if you don't do anything about it, God's hands are tied, because he's the one that put the law into effect. By your words, you're justified. By your words, you're condemned. It says in James chapter 3, just like you can take a rudder of a ship and turn a ship any way you want to, and just like you can put reins in a horse's mouth and pull those reins and tell that horse where to go, the tongue will take your life in the way that you speak. That's Bible. Whatever you're saying is the way that you're going. If you don't learn how to talk the way the Bible says talk, you're not going to make it with any kind of victory in your life. You'll never slay the giants that are trying to come against you, because they are going to get the upper hand. In the wilderness, Jesus was tempted of the devil. After he had been fasting for 40 days, the devil came to him and tempted him. And every temptation, Jesus defeated the devil by saying, "It is written." He didn't defeat him by knocking him in the head. He did not defeat him with some supernatural, heavenly weapon. I'm sure God, even back when Jesus was on the earth, had the formula for a hydrogen bomb. But Jesus did not use a hydrogen bomb on the devil. He used words. He quoted Deuteronomy and defeated the devil. Now, if Jesus had to defeat the devil by using words, I believe we need to understand that we have to defeat the devil, and we gain the victory in life by what we say. For whosoever, the Bible says in Mark 11, 23, how many is a whosoever? Is that some of you? About three. All right. For whosoever shall say to that mountain, "Be thou removed and cast into the sea," and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that what he saith shall come to pass. He shall have whatsoever he saith. Not what you believe and say comes to pass. See, there's a lot of people believing, I'm a believer. Folks, if you're a believer and talking doubt, you don't receive anything from God. It's your words that justify you. It's your words that bring into creation the things that God has already paid for. Now we see that in David's life. Before David ever headed down the mountain into the valley where Goliath was, he said this to Saul in 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 36. He said, "Thy servant," talking about himself, David, "thy servant slew both the lion and the bear." And, now listen to him. I mean, he's bold. Sometimes you're going to live for God, you need to get bold with what you talk about. You need to grab yourself by the ear and say, you need to shut up with that doubt and unbelief, because you're going to go that way if that's the way you're talking. But he said, "And this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he hath defiled the armies of the living God." And David said, "Moreover, the lion that the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of the Philistine." And Saul said, "Okay, man, if that's the way you're talking, go get him, buddy. And here, I'll give you my sword, and I'll give you my shield, and I'll give you my armor." And David said, "Well, no, it's too big for me, it doesn't fit too good. And I haven't proved them. I've got something here I've proved. I've got a sling, I proved my sling." And so he starts out. Now, to me, it's hilarious that all of these mighty warriors of a natural army that are strong and powerful, not cowards, mighty men in the natural, see a little teenager boy, no armor, no helmet, got a sling and five smooth stones, and starts running down the mountain. I mean, he's not going down there, "Oh, don't know how this is going to turn out." Running down the mountain. And while he's running down the mountain, he begins to say this in 1 Samuel 17, 45. "Then said David to the Philistine, Thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defiled. This day will the Lord deliver thee into my hand." I mean, he's saying it. "This day will the Lord deliver thee into my hand, and I will smite thee and take thine head from thee, and I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistine this day to the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know there is a God in Israel." Yeah. Hallelujah. Woo. Praise God. Would to God that we would see some people today rise up in indignant anger at the way the world is going today and the way the devil is creating God's, doing what he's doing to God's people, and decide, "No, that's about as far as you can go, devil. I've had all that I'm going to take. My God is still alive today, and he's made a way, thank God, for me to come out in victory. And I'm coming after you." See, we ought to go after the devil. Instead of hunkering down somewhere, dreading the devil coming, we ought to rise up and say, "Devil, you're not going to have my job. You're not going to have my money. You're not going to have my health. I'm taking it. I'm getting it right now." Praise God. See, this was what he was doing. All he had was a sling. That sling wasn't a match for the giant. But there was a God in Israel. How many know a God in Israel can turn a sling into a mighty atomic weapon? whatever he wants to do. Hallelujah. Now in our text scripture, now this is what we can call the law of confession, the scripture we read at the beginning of the service. Romans chapter 10, verse 6. And it's simple but profound. But the righteousness, that means the right standing. How many want to be in right standing with God? Righteousness is what makes you in right standing with God. The righteousness which makes you in right standing with God is of faith. The righteousness is of faith. That means you can't get righteous without faith. Faith is what makes you righteous. But he speaks on this wise. Don't say in your heart who's going to ascend into heaven and bring Christ down, or who's going to descend into the deep, that is to bring Christ up again from the dead. The word is nigh thee, in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we speak. That is the word of faith which makes you righteous and gives you everything that belongs to you, because it's talking about salvation. Confession is made unto salvation. So we're talking about salvation. When we talk about salvation in the Greek, now I know we've watered down salvation, it means you go to heaven. But folks, you don't need a lot of salvation to go to heaven. But you need a lot of salvation to live on the earth. Salvation in the Greek is S-O-Z-O. I think it may be sozo, but that's coming from somebody that doesn't know. But sozo, or S-O-Z-O, means salvation, healing, preservation, soundness, wholeness, complete. In other words, when Jesus Christ went to the cross, he did it for you so that, actually, Calvary is this. The sinless Son of God who needed nothing took upon himself all the bad due humanity because of their disobedience, so that we in turn could have all the good that belongs to Jesus because of his obedience. That means you don't earn it, you don't deserve it, because the Bible says, by grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourself, it's a gift of God. So everything that comes with salvation is a gift from God that you don't deserve. The only way you get it is to confess Jesus Christ as Lord and believe God raised him from the dead. See that what we're preaching here. So you can't go up in heaven and say, oh, God, come down here and help me, God, help me, God. Or try to dig him up from the grave and say, I know maybe you're having a little trouble yourself, but I need help, God, help me, God. No, God says, you don't need me to come down. You don't need me to come up. Everything you need is near you. It's in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the lordship of Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be healed, delivered, set free, made whole. Hallelujah. For with the heart man believes, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, healing, preservation, deliverance, complete, you know, wholeness, everything that Jesus paid for, your needs met. Jesus, who was rich, the Bible says, became poor that you through his poverty might be rich. See, I'm preaching to a lot of rich people in here that don't even know they're rich. It didn't say you might become rich. It said you be rich. You be rich. Well, I don't feel rich. We don't live by how we feel. We live by what we believe. If you believe you're poor and talk poor, you'll stay poor. If you believe that Jesus Christ died, that you could be rich and have all your needs met according to his riches in glory, and that he would withhold no good thing, then you can begin to talk like you believe it, and pretty soon you'll start believing it. Did you know even liars can say it long enough and start believing it? You have to put faith into your heart, and once it gets into your heart, then thank God when you say it, it brings to pass what you say. This is what Confession 101 is all about. You don't have to get God to come down every day and solve your problems. He's already solved them. 2,000 years ago at Calvary, he solved every problem that you would face in this life. Every giant that would try to nip at your tail and try to defeat you and discourage you has been defeated by Jesus Christ. And now it's time for the great army of God to rise up and say, okay, I have read the Bible and I've seen what God has done for others, but I know God's no respecter of persons. If he did it for one, he's going to do it for another, and I'm expecting God to move on my behalf. Now, if you don't start confessing what you believe, faith is never activated. See, you do not receive because you believe. Because faith has to be activated with words. You don't activate faith watching TV. You activate faith when you speak that uncircumcised Philistine. How dare you defy the armies of the living God? Today I'm going to cut your head off and feed your flesh to the fowls of the air and to the beasts of the field. And that's exactly what happened. It's because he believed it, he said it, and he acted upon it. See, I say this every time I preach and talk about faith because I want all of us to be on the same page. Faith in all of its simplicity. God doesn't want it to be hard. God wants it to be simple. He's trying to get everybody in on the game. Faith is believing that God told the truth. God cannot lie. But God didn't lie. God cannot lie. So if it's in this Bible, it is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And if in the Bible it says, by the stripes of Jesus, you were healed. Were healed. Are healed. Not going to be healed. That's the truth. Now, it doesn't help that that is the truth in the Bible. What we have to do is believe it's the truth, talk like it's true, act like it's true, and live like it's true. Anyone that wants to get out of the mess you're in, you have to know that God has a promise exactly fitting your situation. And you say, well, why doesn't he give it to me? Because he gave you a mind. He gave you eyes to read. He gave you understanding that when you read something, you can comprehend it. He wants you to know there is a weapon laying on your coffee table or sitting somewhere with dust on it that somebody ought to read. And you're hoping you'll go to church on Sunday and somebody will stand up and get you out of your mess that you're in. I thank God that every once in a while, God will use a preacher to help you. But if you won't help on a consistent, everyday, long-term basis where you don't stay in one problem after another problem, but you begin to get delivered from this problem, and then thank God something on the inside clicks, and you think, if I got delivered from that one, I believe I could get delivered from this other one, and you'll get delivered from another one, and if you get delivered from that one, pretty soon you're thinking, hallelujah, there's nothing the devil can do to me that will sink my boat. I'm coming out on top. I've got the victory through Jesus Christ. Now, that is the way Christianity works. Nobody else is going to deliver you. Now, they can. God, now, you know, you have to qualify everything you say because God's God. How many believe God can do anything he wants to do without asking my permission? One thing he will not do is violate his word. we have confidence that God will not violate his word. But he does say, I'll show mercy on who I want to show mercy to. And I don't have to account to you for my mercy. But folks, in a room full this big, there may be two or three that get mercy. But I've got some good news for you. If you hadn't found out before today, I want you to know that every born-again child sitting in this seats this morning, you have the weapon that'll get you out. It's not in heaven to be prayed down. It's not in the deep to be prayed up. It's near you. It's in your mouth, in your heart and in your mouth. And when you start saying what's in your heart based on the word of God, you have released faith for God to work and God to move. Now, if we know that, we ought to do something about it. I've preached this message. I've been preaching this message 50 years. When I pastored here, I don't know how many times I preached it. Not the same message, but the essence. Your words are important. Your words are important. But I'm dealing with something that has been grained into the human race. It's a trick of the devil. In fact, to talk the way I'm teaching you sounds arrogant. To talk like the world sounds normal. Well, I'm scared to death. I'm afraid so. I'm dying to go. I'm sick and tired of all these kids. I mean, that sounds like good old American normal talk. But what sounds strange to our ears is when somebody says, with nothing but a sling, running toward a giant, today, I'm going to cut your head off. I'm going to feed your carcass to the birds and to the fowl of the air. Arrogant. No, he is saying what he believed. He was saying something that we Christians need to learn to say. I can't go around just talk any way I want to talk because my idle words are defeating me. They're bringing me down. And, you know, Jen and I found out the importance of words probably over 50 years ago, long time ago. When you get 80, everything seemed like it was yesterday, you know. But it was a while back. And so we practiced. I mean, I said, now, if you hear me say anything wrong, you help me. And if I hear you say anything wrong, I'll help you. Well, I'm telling you, when you start out, everything you say is wrong. And you know, and really, you don't want to be corrected by your wife. That just irks you. Say something, and then she'd, well, you want me to agree with that? No, I don't want you to agree with that. I mean, you start trying to change the way you talk. It's important the way you talk. So over the years, one of the things we've done is we've corrected each other. But I practice. Did you know there's not an army on this earth that does not have to be trained and practice and work at it? There's not a football team that has won a championship that didn't practice and practice and practice. But yet the church of the living God goes through life like, oh, whatever will be, will be. What are we going to do? Nothing. Oh, you know, the devil's just got me down. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know how I'm going to get out of this mess. Everything just looks so bleak. Oh, I wish the Lord had come today. Get me out of this mess. No, God's got you down here to clean the mess up. Not live in it. Clean it up. Do something about it. And so I've been saying, since the early 70s, when I found out my words are getting me in trouble. My words are trying to kill me. And I started saying, well, thank God I'm a born-again child of God, perfect, entire, wanting nothing, sound in my spirit, sound in my soul, sound in my body. I know God. I know His voice. I hear His voice. My steps are ordered of the Lord. I'm sound in my spirit. I'm sound in my soul. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. My will is submitted to the will of God. My emotions are under the control of my reborn spirit. I'm sound in my soul. I'm sound in my body. I live in divine health. Jesus Himself took my infirmities and bare my sicknesses, and with His stripes I am healed. I see perfectly. I hear perfectly. My heart is perfect and normal. My blood pressure is perfect and normal. My sugar level is perfect and normal. My spleen is perfect and normal. My kidneys are perfect and normal. My gallbladder is perfect and normal. My prostate's perfect and normal. All of my inward parts function perfectly and normal. No infection, germ, bacteria, growth, hernia, skin disease of any sort, contrary to my health, appearance, or comfort, can live in or on my mortal body. No arthritic condition, joint condition, bone condition, muscle condition, sinew condition, nerve condition, contrary to my health, appearance, or comfort, can live in or on my mortal body. I live in divine health, divine peace, divine joy, divine happiness, divine prosperity. My Heavenly Father meets all of my needs according to His riches and glory. I have given, and it's given unto me, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. I have sown bountifully, and I reap bountifully. And my God's making all grace abound toward me, so that I always, having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. Thank God I am submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, and I resist the devil, and he flees from me. I resist cancer. Cancer flees from me. I resist high blood pressure. High blood pressure flees from me. I resist whatever causes my eyes to water excessively and not to drain properly. I resist it. I resist arthritis pain. Thank God I'm healed from the top of my head to the sole of my feet. Living in divine health with all my needs met. Now, folks, you can't say that for 50 years without it. You start to believe it. I never expect to get sick. I expect to stay well. I expect to grow old, strong. I'll fulfill the call of God on my life. When I'm over, I'll just lay down and die. I'm not going to go to a nursing home because I'll be well. Well, people don't go to nursing homes. Well, you say you sound pretty arrogant. No, I'm saying what the Bible says. And God can't lie. I know the devil tries to beat you down and say, don't say that, don't say that. Actually, we're so superstitious, we think if we say it, it'll happen bad. That's a lie from the pit of hell. When you talk like the Bible's true, the Bible starts to work. It's time us Christians woke up and decide, I'm not going to let the devil defeat me. I'm going to start believing that what God said is true. See, it's hard for most people, especially lost people, and I hate to say it, many Christian people, and I could even add many spirit-filled Christian people, think if you say anything that's positive based on the Word of God and say it with authority, that somehow or another you're wrong. But that is a lie from hell. Christians ought to be very positive on the Word of God because God can't lie. And if God said it, it has to be true. What He wants me to do is to believe it. Now, I don't go around trying to correct people the way they talk. And I don't go around saying what I said to you in front of lost people. And, you know, the Bible says don't throw your pearls before swine. Don't just say things to try to impress people. I'm saying what I'm saying so I can hear myself say it. And God can hear me. I don't care what other people think. I'm not trying to impress people. I'm trying to get God's Word in my spirit. Because when it gets in my spirit and I believe it, I can have what I say based on the Bible. So it's important. Now, sometimes as you go through life, you find yourself in situations and giants are nipping at your heels and you seem like you're defeated. Let me give you just a little bit of help that'll help you. The Bible says, by grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourself, it's a gift of God. Grace means you don't deserve it. If you did deserve it, you couldn't get it. Right? That's what grace. Grace is unmerited, undeserved favor of God. So when you're believing God, don't get under condemnation and say, well, you know, and all of us have been through this. I'm not picking on anybody. But see, you can say, well, I don't want to go to a doctor. I don't want God to thank me. I don't trust him. Not going to the doctor won't make God trust you. God already loves you, died for you, paid the price for you to have everything that comes through the Lord Jesus Christ. And there's nothing you can do to make God give it to you. Amen. Except accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and believe that God raised him from the dead. And there's nothing that you can do to make God withhold it from you. All you have to do is believe it in your heart and say it with your mouth and believe it'll come to pass. So, if you're fighting a battle, don't get under condemnation. If you've got a bad headache and you're believing God to heal your headache, take an aspirin. You say, oh, no faith. Doesn't have anything to do with faith. It might give you some relief from the headache, but it doesn't bother your faith. Your faith is not in the aspirin. Your faith is in what God said. What did God say? Find out if you don't know. Find out what God said. You can't find in the Bible where God said don't take an aspirin. Now, I know that'll some of you religious people, that'll really hurt you. But just get over it. I'm telling you, David had a slingshot. Now, if he had been like some spirit-filled Christians that I've run into, and myself included at times in my life, you think, I'm not having anything to do with natural things. I'm believing God. He could have run down that off that hill and threw a slingshot away and said, I'm trusting God. I don't need a slingshot. How many know today we wouldn't have the story of Goliath being killed? He took something natural and used it for God. Did you know the Bible says every good gift and every perfect gift cometh down from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there's no variableness, neither shadow of turning? If it's good and it's helping, don't disdain it. Embrace it. Has nothing to do with your faith. Faith does not come from doctors, and doctors cannot hinder faith. All we can do is stand on God's word, get it into our heart, start confessing it. Now here's the end of the story. The Bible says in Romans 10, confession is made unto salvation. Confession is made unto healing, deliverance, provision. Confession is made unto. How do you get to salvation? Confession is made unto. It did not say confess it is made unto. Confessions are made unto. In other words, to get to healing, you start talking healing, confessing healing. And soon, you may not get there tomorrow. You may not get there the next day. But here's good news. If you stay on the highway, you'll get there. If you said to me, Brother Gene, how do you get to Birmingham? Get on I-20 and go west, and you'll get to Birmingham. And if you get on I-20, you might go to Villarica and say, this doesn't look like Birmingham to me. I must be going the wrong way. And you could get off and ask somebody, and you might get the wrong answer. Some people know how to get to Birmingham. Some people don't know how to get to Birmingham. But I'll guarantee you one thing, absolutely true. I-20 will take you to Birmingham. Now, I can say with more authority than I can, because You know, something could happen to I-20. But nothing's going to happen to this. Praise God. So I can say with authority, if I'll stay unto saying what God's word has said, and it gets into my spirit, and faith is germinated and created, the time will come when I got it. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now I want us to slay some giants this morning. Many of you have giants that you're facing. And I want you to stand up. We're just where you are. We're going to take authority over those giants this morning. And you're going to get victory over it. Hallelujah. Praise God. I don't care what the giant is. If it's contrary to the word of God, it doesn't belong in you. All right. First thing I want you to do is take the sling, which is the word of God. That's the way. We called it slingshot when I was growing up. You aim, but back in those days, a slingshot, you put it in a little thing and you slung it. That's why you got sling. All right. What is your giant? We're going to take, it's the word of God. It represents the word of God. So here, let me lead you in a confession. Father, in the name of Jesus, I believe the word of God is true. I believe God cannot lie. I confess Jesus Christ is my Lord. And I do believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead, and he's in heaven as my Lord and Savior. And everything he paid for at Calvary belongs to me by divine right. Therefore, devil, I put you on notice. You uncircumcised Philistine, I'm going to cut your head off with the word of God and the power of faith. I declare now, you are defeated. I will feed your carcass to the birds and to the fowls and to the beast of the field. I am delivered, and I will stay delivered. I'm coming up and not going back down. That's my decision based on the word of God. In Jesus' name. Amen, 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 amen. Let's give God praise for that.